for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
Underwriting for Community Radio on WSKB is brought to you in part by Rockies. Over 30 convenient locations throughout Massachusetts, Rhode Island, New Hampshire, Connecticut, and Florida. One of the nation's largest Ace dealers. Expertise and great product selection in paint, hardware, lawn and garden. That's Rockies, rock solid service since 1926. On the web at Rockies.com.
I'm Mark Auerbach. Join me every Friday at 8 a.m. for Arts Beat, where you'll meet interesting actors, directors, designers, and musicians here in Western New England.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Everybody, good morning. My name is Eric Ouellette. I'm the executive director of the Greater Westfield Chamber of Commerce. And my guest this morning is our illustrious superintendent of Westfield Schools, Mr. Stefan Zaporowski. Thanks for joining me this morning, Stefan.
My pleasure. Good morning.
Yeah. So I got to preface by saying, Pete, I've got the celebrity on the show today. You know, he's got, what, like three or four shows that he's on every
multifaceted.
Week. Yeah, right. So we were just saying how cold it was outside. It's finally winter. It was 20 degrees when I left my house this morning.
Yeah.
And, you know, the
price. It was a little chilly when I woke up at 4:30.
Yeah, I'm assuming it was less than 20 degrees when you woke up.
Yeah.
But, you know. Talking about the price of oil, and I got an oil tank that I gotta put oil in soon here. And last time I put oil in it, it was $4.99 a gallon, and I believe it was over $5 for you. You had said
I paid $5.85. I was at its peak, so I haven't had a fill up since. Hopefully, it's gone down.
Right. So we'll see. I know gas. I usually get gas at the Citgo station right off the Pike when I get off. It was $2.89 this morning.
I was just going to say gas prices are down. One would think oil prices should be down too.
So we'll see. Fingers crossed. Yeah. When I need to put oil and or gas in my car in the next next time. But anyway, Stefan, thanks for coming on this morning. We've got a lot to talk about. More specifically with WeTuba and our career fear here. So yesterday we had our I'd say kickoff meeting. We kind of had everything scheduled already, but we had our kickoff meeting for our career fair, which is taking place on March 16th over at the college.
Yeah, so in the Woodward Center.
In the Woodward Center.
So thank you to Westfield State for generously donating their space for us.
Right.
We appreciate that. Fortunately, they're a chamber member too.
They are. They're one of our platinum members. They're great. And the next, I'll say at the end of the show, but we have our St. Paddy's Day breakfast there the very next day. Everybody can stay. We'll sleep over in the Woodward Center and it'll be good. Tell the audience a little bit about how the career fair kind of started.
Sure. So we actually started it. My gosh, I want to say right before the pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
And we had so I would say 2018, 2019, we had to cancel 2020.
Mm-hmm.
But the idea was for folks, our students in particular, one, to get that experience in meeting with business folks,
right.
business people, but also for our students to see what Westfield has to offer. And there are a lot of employment opportunities here. There's a lot of business here. I'm preaching right here, but you know. And while we know a lot of our kids are going to go to college and probably go away, we want to let them know, you know what, you can come back here, you can get a great job here, and you can have a nice life here
in
Westfield. So, but then I was also talking, you know, working with our business partners, and part of it is also trying to develop, you know, I know some people call them soft skills, but we call them essential skills,
mm-hmm.
skills that our students need to be successful, whether they're going into a career or college.
Right.
So It's interesting. You know, our first year we had about 30 businesses, then we were up to like almost 50, then we had to pause, and we resumed last year, and we had almost 75. Right,
right, right, just about.
So it was great. I mean, if you looked at the, you know, there's a, I took a picture from the bleachers,
yeah, right,
and you
right.
saw all the businesses that were there, and the kids really interacting mm-hmm. with businesses, and I know some of the kids here were at the Technical Academy, for those who don't yep. know, it's where our studio is. You know, they come, some of them are bringing resumes and, mm-hmm. and leaving with them employment opportunities right there.
Right.
And, you know, we work with our high school students as well to kind of get them interested. And it's, you know, just some of the businesses that are there are perfect, like Wally Computer. I'm just going to shout mm-hmm. them out because they're involved in a lot of stuff for us.
And, right.
Our IT students here are the IT students that are at the high school. Westfield Police Department always shows up. Last year, I believe they brought one of their dogs, right? So,
right.
Yeah, that was a big hit.
Yep.
But, you know, the banks, Gas and Electric is a huge supporter. And I know they take students, they hire kids from Westfield High and Westfield Technical Academy all the time. Mm-hmm. So it's just a great community event.
Yeah.
And yeah. exposes our students to things that you don't really would get exposed to in
right.
school. And it's a real world, real life experience.
Right. And not just community event, too. We had MGM there last year.
Right.
You know, it's the surrounding businesses within the Pioneer Valley. So, again, we talked about this yesterday, that we don't necessarily want to stay within the community as much
right.
as we do. You know, you can still live in Westfield and work in Springfield or
absolutely.
Northampton or wherever else. So,
and I know we have students that graduated even from the program next door. I point next door because
right.
Culinary Arts is right next door. And I know our some of our kids are going to work there.
Mm-hmm.
So they also support the culinary / hospitality program at Westfield High School. And
right.
MGM is pretty much, from what I can see, always hiring.
Right.
You know. I think everybody is at
yeah,
actually
hiring,
okay.
yeah, yeah, right, right.
But you know, MGM has been a good partner to us as well. So, really, any surrounding community can participate,
right?
And I just think it's a good experience for our kids. I think it's a good experience for our businesses. It's nice that they're willing to give back a little bit, and
mm-hmm.
I think they recognize, you know, this is the workforce of the future.
Right, right. And a lot, and that's just it. You know, to take advantage, it's free. By the way, you know,
yeah.
For businesses to come to the event, it's free. It's show up, set up a table, and you know how important is it for your respective business to do recruitment for tomorrow's leaders.
Right.
You know? So we've had law firms show up. You know, we said banks, the police departments, the fire department.
Fire
there.
Department. I think the technology center from City of Westfield's technology
yep.
center was there. As I'm just trying to go around the room. I mean, Westfield State, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's and I want to shout out Westfield State too, because you know, they're also looking for students to attend their school.
Right.
And
right.
for a lot of our kids, that's an affordable option
mm-hmm.
in comparison to some of the other places.
Right.
I mean, that's a whole nother story.
Yep.
I feel like sometimes the colleges are pricing themselves out of business,
right?
But,
right.
Which is why their enrollment is
yeah,
down.
Correct.
So, you know, and there's a career center. So we work with Junior Delgado
yep.
also at Westfield State, and he helps us put this together. And you know, we also give away some prizes and things of that nature for
an
the
incentive.
Kids.
An
yes,
incentive.
An incentive.
So it's not just a show up and walk around and collect swag. As great as that is,
yes.
But it's also you know, an opportunity for kids to go out and talk to some of these businesses. And again, you know, you've got your heart set that you want to be a Hampden County sheriff or a police officer.
Right.
And when you find out what it entails, at the end of the day, you may say, yeah, I definitely don't want to do that anymore.
Right.
So.
And that's the thing. I feel like the earlier we expose our kids to careers, the better off we are. And that's why every spring, really late spring, but we do even career events at our elementary schools,
mm-hmm.
which a lot of chamber members come
yep.
and speak to classes.
Right.
And you know, and I've gone and talked about obviously education and things of that nature, but the police always seems to have the best presentation because they bring like shields and all kinds of cool stuff.
Right,
that,
right.
You know, I'm a superintendent. I'll bring you a pencil.
Right, right.
You know, what am I bringing? So it's just exciting, and I love that we do it, and I think. You know, getting our kids thinking about careers as soon as possible
mm-hmm.
is important. And that's why we kind of relaunched the Career Center at Westfield High School. We have a partnership with Mass Higher Holyoke right now to get our kids out into, you know, even their junior and senior year. If
right.
they think they want to go into a career, let's get them exposed to that career first. I mean,
yep.
the last thing you want to do as a student, right, is think you want this career, start going to school for it, and then decide you don't like it.
Right, right.
Because you've just, I don't want to say wasted money, but
you kind of did.
Yeah.
Right,
so,
right, yeah.
And,
right.
And so if we can get you on that path, I think it's just a great thing. And sometimes, like, we'll take the elementary kids over to the hangar to see them for aviation.
Right, right.
I know a couple before the pandemic, we brought a group of second graders from Paper Mill, and I think after that, we had a bunch of students interested in aviation early as second grade.
Right.
Well,
right.
It's cool.
Yeah, right.
You know?
Flying a plane. Absolutely.
Yeah,
that,
well, they got
absolutely.
To sit in an airplane.
Yeah, right.
You know,
right,
and that's pretty awesome. So. Anything we can do, I think, to expose our students. And again, here there are 12 programs, right? Mm-hmm. So the students have an idea of what they want. But we're actually asking a student to pick a shop at 14 years old.
Right.
I mean, who at 14 years old knows what they want to do?
Right. Well, and on top of that, with everybody post-pandemic here and being stuck at home for however many years, 18 months, however long school was virtual and everything else, they've got the mentality, they're in eighth grade and they've got the mentality of a fifth or a sixth grader.
Yeah.
So how do you combat that for essentially a sixth grader picking what they want to do for their career at an eighth grade at 14? It's a lot. It's a lot to endure.
It's interesting here because we have exploratory. So the students will spend a one day in every shop and then they will pick their top four and then they spend a week in that shop. And so we try to help them along
right,
with that.
Right.
But there are kids who still switch.
Right.
And we have kids at the high school that said, you know what, maybe I should have gone to WTA and they'll come over midway freshman year or sophomore year. So it's important for us to be flexible too,
right,
because we want to meet the students where they are.
Right.
And also give them an opportunity to work in a career.
Right.
You know, this shop in itself is a career.
It is.
For our kids.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely. And I think it's, you know, it's a testament, you know, Peter and I were talking before the show here that, you know, there's a lot of opportunities, especially in the broadcasting area, you know, whether
they're all hiring. Pete, I saw, I think Western Mass News, WGGB or whatever, has a thing. We're hiring all the time.
Oh, yeah. They're looking for people.
They are.
Yeah.
And they have like an open invitation for high school kids to come visit their studios. And I know Steve has brought them there.
Yes.
So, yeah.
Both stations are hiring. I know WWLP is looking for master control, I think, right
they
now.
They are.
Yeah.
Because they run five different stations out of Chicopee.
Well, they were also looking for a meteorologist for a while. I mean, there's just a lot of opportunity.
Yeah, yeah. And is that – so I guess Peter would know this. Is this can kids graduate high school and go right into the news world, the media publications world? Or is
they really have – if they learn all of the shop that – everything the shop has to offer, not only just the TV production part, but they learn the Adobe suite and things like that, those are skills that are invaluable to them in the news media business. Or in marketing, or in public relations, or in a multitude of fields that you really need to know how to shoot, edit, design, logo design, you know, print publications. They need to know all of that to be in that field right now.
Pete, I mean, didn't you go right into the field?
Pretty much, yeah. I tried to go to Stick, but I never finished. because I kept getting full-time jobs.
Right.
You know. I worked for Continental Cablevision back in the day. I was in my early teens and 20s, and then I worked for Munson Palmer Cable Access. I worked for Channel 40. I worked for a satellite uplink operator, all kinds of stuff before I got into municipal, and then I switched to public safety.
Right.
And those skills translated over to public safety.
Well, that's interesting. Right. The skills that are transferable. And that's what I think is great and what our mission, what we're trying to do is, regardless of what career path you pick, there are certain essential skills that you need.
Correct.
And we need to teach them. We've heard that loud and clear from our businesses. We're working on it.
Right. Right.
You know, while still trying to deal with the state mandates that come at us.
Right.
But, you know, it's the right thing to do for kids.
Right. Again, and to be able to have the opportunity to explore during this career fair of exactly what their passion is or they think their passion is until they find out what, you know, again, you said earlier how much college is, you know, to go to college to be, to get a law degree or whatever else.
Wow.
You find out that, you know, now you're spending, what, over $100,000 or even more, you know, depending on what kind of law you're going into.
Well, because typically a bachelor's isn't enough.
Right.
So you got to keep going. You're
spending
more than $100K.
Right. Fair enough.
And I think what people are starting to realize is, okay, so you graduate with all this debt and you're paying it off till you're 40?
Yep.
I mean, about, easily.
Just about. I got a couple more years left on my student loan.
There you go. And then, so how do you buy a house? How do you get a car or an apartment or any of that? And I think that's why you find some young people still living with mom and dad.
Right. And it, I mean, when the debt that is incurred, and it's, you know, and the, on the other side of that though too, it's when you go into school for something that you know you're not going to make a ton of money on, you know, the sad reality is you still have to pay those loans.
You
back.
Do.
So asking for loan forgiveness and everything else that comes down the pipeline, I know I laugh. It's like I've been paying my loans for 15 years now.
So
give or take, and it's I've been paying them right along, you know, but I'm not a music major or anything else where I can't get a job. You know, I went to school to be a police officer. I went to a military college to be a police officer, and now I'm running the chamber. Who would have thought, you know?
And that's the thing. I mean, I think, you know, you think you have an idea of what you want to do, but your skill set allowed you to do what you're doing now as well.
Correct.
And that's the important piece. So I try to emphasize, even if this isn't your career, there are still a lot of skills that you can learn that are transferable.
Correct, yeah. And I think that, again, it's this career fair. It's for high school juniors, too, by the way. I want to preface by saying it's for high school juniors. And it gives, again, just the opportunity to walk around and see what their essential passion is going to be. And you can tell the difference of students, whether they're at the high school or at the tech academy, of who's prepared and who's not.
Yeah.
Some of them come dressed, you know, in business casual, you know, with a written resume ready to go, and others don't.
It's not the culture.
Right.
And here, the culture is different.
Right.
And, you know, there are a week in academics and a week in shop. And for the kids that come here, their shop is very important. So every shop has a program advisory as well, which is made up of business folks.
Right.
And you have to have a parent and a student on there by law, but that's a good thing.
Right.
And so they've already made connections with businesses. Mm-hmm. And sometimes the businesses will come into this classroom and talk with the kids. So the kids know a little bit more about what to expect what it is. I remember the aviation kids, if you remember, they came in their aviation uniforms.
They did, yes, they did.
And which looks sharp, by the way.
They do.
And I think last year we were able to have, was it Gulfstream or Embraer? One of them was there, I thought.
So Fly Lugu.
Fly Lugu was there, too.
And the other at the airport, not Gulfstream.
No, we had...
Western Wright Flight?
Wright Flight. We have had Gulfstream in the past, so we've got to get them back.
We do, yes, absolutely. So, but yeah.
They're always hiring, too, by the way.
Correct, yeah. Well, that's it. Everybody is still hiring.
I was actually driving on North Road, and Bombardier was having a hiring event. So we've got to get those places here, too. And even if, you know, it's not a career, even if you haven't gone through the aviation technology program here, there are other avenues if aviation becomes your passion later in life.
And, again, being able to write a resume at such a young age, too. And, again, kudos to Junior at Westfield State and what they're doing. You know, we'd asked about approaching the high school kids beforehand, saying, hey, you know, can we get maybe a career counselor or maybe a student there to kind of guide them through the process of what to expect when they show up for the career fair? And it's not just I'm gonna show up with the resume, you're gonna ask me questions, and I'm gonna look like a deer in the headlights.
Right.
You gotta be prepared for some of these things. And you know, again, a kudos to the college. And you're right, it's twofold. They want students to go to Westfield State, and they also want them to succeed. So why not have them come to the career fair? And
we have dual enrollment early college program with Westfield State. So our juniors at both here and at the high school are taking stretch classes.
Okay.
So their junior year, they can take at Westfield High School, for example, English 101 and English 11 simultaneously, and it's co-taught by our teacher and a professor from Westfield State. So the students are getting English 11 credits and also English 101. And they do the same at history at the high school. So you can get 6 credits your junior year.
Wow.
And then your senior year, you can take classes on campus. And we even got a van and a driver to bring students up to campus because we didn't want transportation to be a barrier.
Sure.
And so we bring the kids up there. But you can graduate, honestly, with about 18 credits. So, and what's really good about that is that, and I'm sure it's intentional, by the way, but every kid that is part of that Westfield Promise program is automatically accepted into Westfield State.
And that's a great opportunity. And again, I didn't have these options when I was...
No,
when
I would have done that in a heartbeat.
So...
Because I did go to Westfield State.
Yep.
But even if they don't want to go to Westfield State, the credits are transferable.
To any state college?
Really, almost anywhere.
Almost anywhere, yeah. So, and it's, again, it's just a testament to you and the college and what you've been able to put forth here for the students. And it's, again, it's a home run. So, again, the career fair is March 16th, Thursday, March 16th. We do want to say thank you to Westfield Gas and Electric for providing transportation for
yes.
us, which is key. Another big player, as we said earlier,
yeah.
In the career fair and just in general in the city. And again, bringing people back to Westfield after they, whether they're they come to the career fair and work or they go to college,
right.
come back and live in the city and the surrounding communities is our ultimate goal at the end of the day. Westfield's not going to grow and thrive if people don't live here.
Well, and let's be honest, Massachusetts is having a bit of a struggle with that.
Correct.
I think
Correct.
In general, not right. Westfield alone.
Right, right.
People leave.
Right, they do. And we're finding, I'd say, a lot of the folks who own businesses, Fortune 500, 400 companies out in the Boston area are realizing, I can work remotely. I'm going to move out where it's quiet out in the western part of the state. And
so
they
that's
do.
The pandemic after effect, mm-hmm. I think, you know, the remote working. And what I've also found is, you know, we're hiring all the time, too. Mm-hmm. Right.
So, right.
And the most frequent question people ask is, can I work remote? And you're, well, no, we with kids that are in person, mm-hmm. so we really can't offer that. But I do
right.
feel like there's a desire for people to work remote more than ever. Right.
right? And it's comfortability. And I think, again, you know, we were talking yesterday at lunch, you know, there are people who have worked previously during the pandemic that aren't working anymore. And a lot of it is realizing that I'm working to pay for daycare for my kids. So how does that, why am I doing this when
I... Are you segueing right
no,
now?
No, I'm not.
I was going to say, because that's a skill and that's pretty good.
but how can you you know, survive just on one income? Well, they made it work for so long during the pandemic that it just...
They were able to do it.
Able to do it and make sense. I mean, there are a lot of federal incentives, don't get me wrong, which aren't available anymore. So the other question is, where is everybody who was working before?
That's the question. And so, then you see that, you know, the national unemployment rate is like, what, 3.5%?
3.5%, right.
And I don't know what it is in Massachusetts, but it's probably right around
yeah,
there.
Yeah.
And you know, I'm scratching my head. It's like, how is unemployment so low and there's so many jobs open?
Right.
That doesn't take into account the people who have given up and are not on the unemployment rolls anymore and are just not working. And I think the number I heard on a Mike Rowe podcast was over 10 million people just are sitting out on the sidelines that are able-bodied and able to work.
Yeah, I don't know what I did wrong.
Nope.
<'Cause>
me neither.
And in some states, it's because of incentives. In this state, I think the quote was, a family of four that applies for all the social programs they can or most of them can make $120,000 a year.
Oh, my gosh.
It's unbelievable.
In aid.
But the other part of it, too, is... I would just have to leave my house. I don't you have to leave your
the
house?
6 months I was unemployed was the worst time of my life.
Oh my God, I'd go crazy.
I was so depressed
because
I was unemployed. But some people just are sitting out on the sidelines.
I
have to work.
Yeah.
I need to work.
Same here. I was unemployed from October of 20 till April of 21 just because of the reduction in staff that
right.
I was working at. And I didn't want to move. We didn't want to leave my family. I didn't want to leave Massachusetts. I did get a severance, but it was one of those things. I was like, all right, I can watch. If I watch the next couple episodes, I'll finish season 3 of The Sopranos.
I was now, just going to say.
What next season can I start now? But again, in the meantime, and I'm trying to look for jobs, but everybody, and the other side of that too is there were a lot of people, a lot of businesses that had job postings that when you would go to apply, they'd say, we're hiring freeze because of COVID.
Right.
So it's like, all right, I fill out all the applications, ready to go, hit submit, and it's like, oh.
Well, then don't say you're hired.
Yeah, right. Take the post down.
Exactly.
Or at least say, hey, we're not looking to do this until January or February, but here's the lingo and information and everything else here. So,
I know.
But all right, well, we'll take a quick break here. Stefan Zeporowski, superintendent of Westfield Schools, here is my guest on WCPC Channel 15 and WSKB 89.5.
Hey, I'm not complaining 'cause I really need to work, but hitting the mountain. my buddy's got me feeling like a jerk. $100 condo, $200 rent. I get a check on Friday, but it's already spent. Working for a living. Working. Working for a living. Working for a living. Living and a working. I'm taking what they're giving because I'm working for a living.
Programming of WSKB is provided by the Boys and Girls Club of Greater Westfield, serving the youth of the Whip City and surrounding communities since 1969. For more information on the Great Futures Club for ages 3 to 5, happening weekdays, and the Club Teen Center for ages 11 and older, weekdays from 6:30 till 8 p.m., go online at bcgwestfield.org or visit the club at 28 West Silver Street. The Boys and Girls Club of Greater Westfield. Great futures start here.
Join me, Tina Gorman, each week from 6 to 8 a.m. for Wake Up Wednesday, when my guests and I discuss health, wellness, and lifestyle reimagined.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
All right. Welcome back, everybody.
By the way, I found that statistic. Look, those numbers. So times by 1,000. So it's 100,044. So that's 10,044,000 people that are not just sitting on the sidelines right now. Wow. Not total, not in the labor force. And most of them are not looking for jobs.
And you know what perplexes me is that
it's going up year over year.
Yeah, it's going up over. Yeah, exactly.
But the prices of everything are so much more.
Yeah. Yeah, but just with inflation, I mean,
how do you afford all this?
That's, you know, and that's another thing I think people are running into, that their salaries aren't reflecting what with inflation, you know, and
it's across the board. It's not just men, it's women.
It's everywhere. Right. It's everywhere. It's, I mean,
different demographics. Yeah. And you're right about the childcare thing, because there's more women than men sitting on the sidelines right now.
Well, so, I mean, are we segueing to that now? Because it kind of you're kind of leading us there.
Yeah, that's fine. We yeah.
And I can't believe we just talked the first half hour away like that.
I know.
I didn't realize it was that long. No. I hadn't looked at the clock. I hadn't looked at the time.
Listen, when you have a professional such as yourself talking on three different shows, it just kind of goes by.
Yeah.
Before we get into that, just to close out what we were talking about the career fair earlier with our juniors and students, if anybody's interested in having a business at the career fair.
For free.
It is free. F-R-E-E. Free.
Favorite four-letter word.
Yep, free. you can get a hold of myself, eric@westfieldbiz.org, or you can call the school department.
And 572-6403, extension 9. That's me.
And ask for Stefan, and he'll sign you up. But we're in the process of getting our sign-up sheets done, and should be done in the next week or so. But if anybody's interested in any of the businesses, please feel free to get a hold of us. So, So I think we've closed that loop, and you know. But again, just back to the workforce piece. It's how many of those people too are educated? How many people have gone to college, gotten a master's degree, got married, COVID hit, and now they're content being unemployed? That I'd go crazy. That's just me. I applaud anybody who was able to do that. If they're able to, if they've got another income that's sufficient, then great. And you'd want to be a stay-at-home parent, whether you're a mother or a father, or caretaker, and you're able to do that and survive off of one income, kudos to you. I wish I could do that. But
yeah,
it would drive me bonkers. All that money spent to go to college, and then, you know, the world takes a hard right turn, and here you are.
Here you are. So. And let's be honest, daytime television is pretty terrible.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
You can only watch The Price is Right so much. And
I was just going to say, you know, I mean, what are you watching?
Bob Barker, it's what, Drew Carey's dubbed?
Drew Carey's doing it.
Correct, yes.
So, but yeah.
I mean, you can only binge watch Netflix so often,
that's
too.
That's true, too,
so
right.
It's
right.
Like, wow.
Right. All these streaming platforms now that you can just pick different series. But it's, you know, it's businesses now have to be creative on how they reinvent the wheel for people to work.
Right.
And we found that a lot of businesses don't need an office, that they can work from home.
Right.
Or the downsizing, where, you know, you've got, you know, let's look at operations center for Westfield Bank downtown.
Yeah.
They're not open anymore.
Right.
They've just got offices. That used to be a thriving branch.
Right.
You know, and after, once COVID hit, they're not necessarily.
Well, and for a lot of people, when's the last time you physically stepped foot in a bank?
Correct. You go through the drive-thru. Yep.
And would you get direct deposit law? You know, you don't have to cash a check anymore.
Right,
remember
right.
those days?
Yeah.
Those are all gone.
Yeah, and just going in and
so that reduces your overhead, by
right?
the way.
Right, that's true, too. And, again, it's saving, you know, saving monies. But looking at all these different businesses that don't need storefronts, they don't need to work. The city's come up with an incentive for lower-income businesses to offset the cost of the burden of rent for the first several months. And I think only two businesses have taken advantage of it so far. One being I believe it's a pottery shop where the old the pizza place, the billiards place that was downtown.
I know what you're talking about.
So I'm sorry, I apologize.
Bentley Billiards.
Bentley, yeah.
So they split.
That guy's rehabbed that whole building too.
Yep, and they split. Well, that came from the restoration funds and
a little bit. Yeah, some of that came from CPA funds. Yeah.
Right, but a lot of it came from being a landlord and all these financial incentives they get with businesses not being there. That's a whole other issue, though, with a lot of our landlords that don't even live in New England. They're all over the country.
All over the country, right.
So, you know, and I think it's redeveloping these, but getting lower-income businesses to come in and the city providing funds for them and the chamber as well, providing funds to get them going is getting harder and harder because nobody wants to open a business downtown, essentially.
Right.
And it's you got to pick and choose, though, too. You can't just say, all right, well, we'll just take anybody that wants to come in.
Right.
And it doesn't work. So, I mean, you drive downtown, it's rough. So get the green space going in. Mayor announced yesterday the green space is going in. They're breaking ground in March. So the green space over near the PVTA building, that'll begin, he said, the end of March with the hard stop on June 30th, which will be a quick turnaround. So hopefully the ground's thawed by then and they're able to get that done. But that should beautify downtown a little bit. And
I think about that because they want to be they start baseball practice around that time. And if the ground is there's still snow on the ground, they have to do indoor baseball practice. It's just not the same.
Yeah, no, I'm sorry. Not at all.
Nope. A little bit you can do
right,
it.
Yeah.
You really need to get out of the field.
you look at, they're preparing to play indoor stadiums like out in Minnesota or Toronto or whatever else. But
Tampa Bay was the worst stadium I've ever been to.
Really?
Ugh, terrible indoor stadium.
And there, you want to talk about a fan base that doesn't support their team, that's they're consistently.
I went to a Tampa Bay Houston Astros game down there, and there were more Astros. It seemed like there were more Astros fans in the stands.
Yeah.
But they're always competitive.
Right. Oh, yeah, every year. Yeah.
Yeah.
Small payroll, so.
Absolutely.
That's the location of that stadium is horrible, though.
Location's horrible. I mean, you look at it, it's just the field is so fake, it's beyond obvious.
Right.
And it looks cheesy.
Yeah, and a lot of retirees venture down to Florida.
When the Red Sox are playing Tampa in Tampa, you see a lot more Red Sox shirts in the
yeah, of
absolutely.
Course.
Yeah.
And it's you know, again, it's people moving out of state because it's cheaper to live elsewhere because they retire in Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut, everywhere else, and they move down to Florida. No state income tax, and they're able to live off their
well, and they might be done with winter too. I'm thinking.
That's true, too.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
Snowbirds or something? Right?
Yeah. So, one of these days.
Yeah.
I got a while before I can say I'm a snowbird, but I don't even know if I'd want
Me
to go
too.
To Florida. I don't know if I'd want to go live in Florida, though. So
summers are hot.
Summers are very hot and humid. And
I don't mind summers down there.
No, well,
I spend 3 weeks every year down there. It's not that bad.
Well, yeah, 3 weeks though. Snowbirds go for months. They'll
they
leave it.
Yeah, but in the middle of summer, I go. I go in July,
which is an unusual time.
Yeah. Well, that's where all the snowbirds are gone. So see.
And the tickets are cheaper, probably too, Pete. I imagine the flight tickets.
I take the train. So.
Oh, okay. All right.
How long does that take?
Well, I bring my car down to Virginia. I put my car on the train. I bring myself in my car down there.
Put your car on a train?
Wow.
Yeah, there's only one train route, the auto train from Lorton, Virginia to Sanford, Florida, just above Orlando.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
Round trip with my own little private room is $1,100.
Round trip? Well, it's not bad.
It's an overnight trip. So you leave at 5 o'clock in the afternoon and get in next morning around 10.
And you get to sleep, obviously, right?
You can sleep on the train. Yeah.
I wouldn't be able to stay up all that time.
I don't know if I could sleep on a train. That'd be...
Oh, it's great. Rocking yourself to sleep. God, it's like being a baby.
I've just taken the train from New Haven to New York City, and I can't sleep on that.
That's different, though. That's a commuter train.
It is.
Yeah. It's a little rough. I've taken the train from Springfield to Boston, and I paid extra for the quiet train after work one afternoon. And
was it quiet?
Oh, yeah. It was. I mean, it was quiet. You know, they had the trolley, the cart, the beverage cart or whatever. And but it was... Trains are an unexpected, how do I word this? It's a different mode of transportation you don't think of, I guess.
Yeah,
you're either going to drive or you're either going to fly. You never think to take the train. And, you know, we're very lucky to have two train lines that venture through
Westfield. Well, and since I saw this morning on the news, there was a lot of delays, flight delays today because the FAA computers are down.
Right,
and you look
right
at the Southwest mess a few weeks ago and... Yeah, it probably doesn't happen with trains.
I would say not.
Yeah,
you know they.
It does.
It does. Oh boy,
there's delays on trains too.
Oh yeah, I'm sure there are delays, but not
because freight's not supposed to have priority, but they have priority a lot.
Yeah,
Of
course.
But I find it to bring my, so I priced out for the past 2 years, a flight and a car rental for 3 weeks, and it's $2,000 cheaper to bring my own car. Even with gas figured in and everything else.
Wow.
It's $2,000 cheaper to bring my own car.
How is there a train that goes out to Houston? You were talking earlier, Pete.
No. It's the only auto train in the country. Is surprisingly, it's the only route that's ever been profitable.
Mm.
They tried it in the Midwest once, but it didn't work out.
Yeah. Yeah, we're very lucky to have Pinsley, you know, Pioneer Valley Railroad and CSX come through and scare the bejesus out of me every so often. You know?
we're lucky to have a Class 1 railroad that comes through the town.
Yeah. Right, right.
Yeah.
Yeah, very lucky. And, you know, an Amtrak comes by every day between 3:30 and 3:50, depending on traffic.
Yeah, that's the Empire Builder, I think.
Is it?
I think that's what it is, yeah.
Yeah, never.
It comes out of Springfield.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
Springfield to Chicago.
Oh, wow. That, every day?
Yep.
That's different.
Yeah, see, you guys, you know, I'm also a train buff.
Oh, I know that. I'm waiting for you to put a camera up behind my office.
I know. I got to figure that one out. Some of those cameras are actually in now, so yeah. I want to face the other way than the Pilgrim Candle one.
Right, right. Yeah, going past my office around.
Down towards the salt ponds.
Yeah, right, right. So, but yeah, it's crazy. The opportunities we have in Westfield, whether it's rail, flight, you know, we've got manufacturing. We've got the largest manufacturer in mess tech here in town. We've got several banks that are available, and all of these people we're talking about are going to be at that career fair. On March 16th. So, I think we've talked enough about the career fair and what Stefan and I think are gonna improve the city when we take over one day. But
yes,
let's segue a little bit into what's going on in the schools, the school department. There's a lot going on, new programs. What's going on with the new school? You know, the virtual school that has kind of taken off. Started last year? 2 years ago?
This is the second year.
Okay.
So next year. So one of the things that's actually happened is, you know, enrollment was high right after the pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
And we've seen a decline in enrollment in the elementary grades, which makes sense to me because I believe that people want, you know, you need socialization at that age.
Agreed.
And you need play,
agreed,
right? Play is healthy. It's a learning experience all in itself. So with that being said, we're seeing an increase in the high school population. Mm-hmm. So we are looking, and no final decision has been made, but we're looking at possibly going 6 to 12 next year because that's where the vast majority of the students are.
Right, right.
And we can't support K to 5 with small numbers. Mm-hmm. It doesn't make financial sense, right?
Right, right.
So, but that's where I think we're going. But I'll tell you, I think we have probably, I'm biased, but probably the best virtual school because our virtual school is it's interactive all day.
Sure.
And you know, there are a couple of state virtual schools that don't really operate that way. There's the instruction period and then you're kind of on your own.
Right, right.
And we have a very what I think is an engaging model, and also that they do things in person. So there was an article in the Westfield News before the holiday, for example. You know, the kids came in because it's located on the fourth floor of the Westwood building. Mm-hmm. So it's a huge space.
Right.
And one of the reasons we did that, too, is because they have to take MCAS in person. So we have them take it there.
Sure.
What I just, you know, with the high school kids, I think it's meeting a need.
Right.
And so we want to continue it.
How many of those are homeschool kids that have transferred to virtual school?
So we probably brought about 40 kids back from homeschool.
Wow.
And we also brought kids back that went to the Teca or the Greenfield mm-hmm. virtual school.
Right, right.
We brought some kids back from there that were attending that from Westfield. Mm-hmm. So the other thing is, I think it's also easier for, you know, someone has to be home.
Sure.
So if you're working, which we just talked about,
yeah.
but then you have an elementary student, you need to go to work, so you can't
right.
be there to make sure the student is on task,
sure.
right? But I think we're going to continue with it, and I know the state, I don't know where they stand on it. They sometimes, I don't think they love it, but it's an outcome of the pandemic, and mm-hmm. so you have to work with it. There are only about 7 districts that have single district virtual schools,
sure.
and if we were allowed to have, so I can offer school choice to any of our brick and mortar buildings, mm-hmm. minus this one because it's an application school. But if we were ever able to open up school choice to the virtual school, I think our population would double.
Really?
We've gotten a lot of inquiries from families and surrounding communities mm-hmm. asking if they can attend the virtual school, and the state doesn't even allow it as a school choice thing. So we have to say no.
Right, and that also includes receiving funding, because you can't go off whatever the school budget is this year and going into 23-24 school season, whatever you want to call it, school year. If the money's not there, you can't
right.
can't essentially grow. So what other state aids and federal aids are there going to be down the line if virtual schools continue to grow, which, again, I'd say I'm biased, too, that we have one of the best ones in the area, in the state. And, you know, what's going to happen coming down the pipeline with our new governor and lieutenant governor,
right.
and where does education fit into there?
Well, they hired a secretary of education,
mm-hmm.
and he's a charter school guy. So,
okay.
from our perspective, that really isn't necessarily a positive development.
Sure,
but hopefully, maybe that will change.
Yeah,
right.
And, yeah, you've got to open up and broaden your horizons, and especially out this way too, right? I mean, schools are as much as you're learning the same stuff. It's the atmosphere and the what you're getting. What benefit are you getting from living out in the western part of the Massachusetts
right.
and in Westfield that you're not getting in maybe Worcester and
right.
Boston and Fitchburg and South Shore.
One of the things that if I could speak to the new Secretary of Education,
sure.
I would offer this to him, and because we have seen a tremendous number of refugees, immigrants coming in,
mm-hmm.
Probably over 200 in the last 6 to 8 months, and they all come to public school. Why? Why don't they go to the charter schools if they're so wonderful?
Right. right.
And I just feel like it's a, they propose and tout charter schools, but the neediest of people, you're still putting them in the public schools.
Right.
And we're happy to take them.
Sure.
Don't get me wrong. However, if you're funding these charter schools to share the wealth, share the kids.
Yeah,
I mean
right.
you're really burdening, city districts or
right.
town districts
right.
unfairly.
Yeah,
because charter schools take funding from us as it is.
Correct.
So it just doesn't make sense to me.
Right.
If I were Secretary of Education, I would change that.
So you're running in 2020?
No, it's an appointed position.
Sorry.
I wish that, someday when I'm in charge,
yep.
we can make things equal, but
right.
it's not the case. And,
right.
But it's interesting, with the virtual school, I think one of the things we're seeing across the board now, too, is, there's been an increase in illnesses, right?
Right.
And we hear that. And, I mean, I don't love the triple-demic or whatever they're calling it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, but there's RSV, but that is declining, thankfully.
Right.
The flu, it's a pretty tough flu season.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, COVID, and now there's a new variant I heard. I can't even remember the numbers and letters anymore.
Right.
But apparently it is the most infectious one,
right.
Easily spread that
right.
there is.
Right.
So, one of the challenges that we face We need more subs. So we need more substitute teachers. Mm-hmm. So if you are interested, go to schoolsofwestfield.org and click on careers, and there you and can there. Apply right, right there. That is one of our biggest challenges. And then the other thing, too, is with a lot of, so, you know, the state holds school districts accountable for your percentage of attendance,
right.
people attending school.
Right.
And, you know, pre-pandemic, we were about 95%, which mm-hmm. was, you know, we're a little below, a little above state average, depending on the year. And but they're still holding schools accountable for attendance now. And with this triple-demic, it's just crazy because it's like, okay, so you're going to hold us accountable for that, but we tell kids if you're sick, don't come to school because you're just going to spread it to everybody else. So
right.
it's a mixed message to me, and it's a frustrating one.
Yeah, and I can imagine, especially when there's a language barrier between the student and the teacher, where, like as you said, you're getting a lot of refugees and
yeah.
and folks coming into the city that don't necessarily speak English or speak English well. So the communication barrier is difficult, very difficult.
We've had to add staff for our English learner program. And again, you know what? There are kids, and we'll do right by them the mm-hmm. best we can all the time.
Of course.
But there are obstacles that are in the way.
Right.
And so, but that is something we do worry about in terms of attendance. And it's not, you know, we try to get our kids to come to school, but if you're sick, stay home. And if you have COVID, aren't you out like five, I mean, you're supposed to be out 5 days.
Right.
Okay, so, and then you get the flu. Well, you're out probably another 5 days, mm-hmm. and then anything else that comes around. There's a stomach bug that was going around for a while,
right.
too. I mean, it was everything. You know, people always, you know, I hear people taking shots at our February and April vacation breaks, mm-hmm. right? And it's like, yeah, but sometimes it's just good to get the schools emptied and clean.
Cleaned, right.
You know, because there's a lot of people here.
Yeah.
A lot of people.
Yep. Yeah.
And they all have germs. Sorry.
Right.
We all do.
Right.
And
The stomach bug traveled through my house twice. Knock on wood, I did not get it. It was before Christmas.
You're fortunate.
I'm very fortunate.
Because I had it.
Both of my kids and my wife had it. So if I never have to clean up vomit in the next near future, I am okay with that. But my son had a holiday party. He goes to St. Joan of Arc in Chicopee.
Yeah.
They had like a holiday party. He's got, I think he's got 16 kids in his class. The last day before break, there were six or seven that showed up because everybody else was sick or recovering, and they weren't going to send the kids to school for one day.
Well, and so, I went to a lot of the elementary concerts this year
yep.
because we got to have them again,
correct.
Which is nice. But I believe, you know, I got sick the day after break started, and
right.
I think I was sick for Christmas.
Ugh.
And
that's rough.
It was rough.
It's
so,
rough.
And it was not great.
Right. So you know, and I again, you're talking about choruses. We just had a great event at the December breakfast.
Isn't that Westfield High School chorus?
They are amazing. They are very. It's the highlight of the breakfast, I think, every
absolutely.
Year. We could have.
They got a standing ovation.
They
this
did.
Year.
Well, they did the what was it? The group there.
I know what you're talking about.
Straight No Chaser.
Yes.
Yeah. 12 Days of Christmas, and yeah. you know they had it down to a T. It was great.
They learned it in a few days.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, it's stuff like that you know we've missed over the past couple years.
Absolutely.
Right? And we can have sponsors. We can have people get up and talk. We had, I think Chris Rogers said, you know, just a plug to him and what we did with
yep.
the chamber and the keeping warm coat drive. I think we had close to 300 coats when it was all said and done.
We did.
And not just coats, but warm weather clothing, which was great.
Gloves, hats, everything.
Everything, which is...
And the need is there.
And the need is still there because it's wintertime and people still need stuff, which you can certainly get a hold of my office or the school department, talk to Chris or his assistant there.
Lisa Kennedy.
Yep. And get the... feel free to donate. But the chorus is great. I mean, it's one of the
highlights. I've had them on the show.
Yep.
And they're coming out again March 9th, Pete, just so you know. Just giving you a heads up.
It's my son's birthday.
Is it?
Oh. Sing happy birthday.
We'll sing.
So.
Well, we can do that. Yeah. But they go right there,
mm-hmm.
and Ken Stomsky will come in. They set up the mics. The kids just sound amazing.
Right.
And then
Harry's got them on too.
Harry's got them coming too, because their talent is you know it's interesting. So I have monthly superintendent meetings.
Right.
So, and every December, the December meeting, on top of the business that we do, they all one school will bring a chorus. And I'm not going to say which school system brought their chorus, but it's just the difference is palpable.
Sure.
It is so Corey Bruno does a fantastic job, has done that for years,
right?
She's into it. She's just amazing. And the kids, the effort that goes into, and we just have great kids.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, they're just great kids.
And again, the course is great, and students change.
Yeah,
right?
They do.
It's not like you get the same group of students for 10 years. They change.
They graduate.
Every year. Every year. They get new students coming in.
They do.
And old ones going out. And it's a testament to Corey. And again, it's just one of the benefits of coming to school here. So what are some of the new programs that are going on at the Tech Academy or the high school that are worth, that are noteworthy, I guess, for the show?
So we actually received an anonymous donation.
Okay.
For our carpentry program.
Okay.
And it's construction tech, and you know they're building a house. Mm-hmm. And they just finished the house last year on Lewis Street, right? So I don't know if I should say that, but if you drive by, they built it. And then this one is on Mill Street. You can see it. You know, we did a groundbreaking after mm-hmm. I always laugh at that because it was already started, but hey, whatever. You know, the kids work really great, but one of the programs we don't have is cabinet making, and mm-hmm. that is another huge need. So we are adding a cabinet making program inside of the construction tech shop. Mm-hmm. And so it's going to require a bunch of equipment, another teacher. We're going to add all of that for next year. I'm very excited about it. Right now, if kids want cabinet making, the only school in this area that offers it is Smith Vocational, so they have to go there.
Right.
Now they won't have to. And Wayne Bush, he's one of our instructors mm-hmm. there. I mean, he has his own business with cabinetry.
Yep.
So it really fits right in the wheelhouse.
Sure.
And it's, again, a very rewarding career.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of money in that. So we're also, you know, at Westfield High School, we are moving along with we have about 55 kids in our criminal justice program. Mm-hmm. It is not Chapter 74 certified, which is a shop, mm-hmm. right, through the state, but we're working on that too. And, you know, this fall we had a state police helicopter land out here at Yockham Field. How many school districts do that? Come on.
Yeah.
You know, but it was awesome because the kids were able to talk to the state police and figure out, you know, what their career is. So mm-hmm. here, if you have a interest in police work and aviation, it's a twofer, you know? So just, again, exposing kids to opportunities. So, also at the high school, you know, we have an early childhood, program, mm-hmm. and we'd like to look at getting that Chapter 74 certified down the road, too, which is going to lead me to the preschool conversation, I think, too, because one of the things, you know, we have the Student Opportunity Act funding, which came to us through Governor Baker, mm-hmm. but the districts had identified three areas where they were going to utilize these funds to improve the school district. So our first area was to expand preschool,
mm-hmm.
and because particularly with the pandemic, I think we realized how important preschool is, and students coming into our schools, particularly with the pandemic, some of them didn't go to preschool. Kindergarten isn't even mandatory in Massachusetts.
Mm-hmm.
So some of them are coming in as first graders with very little skills. There's all kinds of research that tells you students that go to preschool are far more successful academically, mm-hmm. Socially, emotionally, and they're coming to school with already a skill set, coming to kindergarten where you have to start learning standards that the state mm-hmm. Puts out there, ready to learn.
Right.
So our goal is to expand preschool. So this year we've got at Southampton Road two preschool classrooms. It's a pilot.
Mm-hmm.
And next year, and it's at no cost right now because we have grant funding to offer it that way. And next year we still have grant funding. So we're expanding one classroom at Munger Hill and one classroom at Highland Elementary School.
Okay.
So, you know, one of the things that we know is that there are a lot of kids in Westfield that aren't going to preschool.
Mm-hmm.
The new school, which is on target, but also has two preschool classrooms built in it for Abner Gibbs and Franklin Ave area students. So, you know, my hope is that we're able to expand. I believe Chicopee, Springfield, and Gateway are offering free preschool now.
Right.
And they're full-day programs, which is another thing that is important to working parents,
mm-hmm.
right? And then you do the wraparound services, which means like the YMCA programming in the morning or the afternoon or the Boys and Girls Club or any of those things, because working parents need that.
Yeah.
But the kids also need it.
Agreed.
So it's a win-win.
Yeah.
And, you know, that was one of our goals, and I would like to see it. Now, Fort Meadow was also very important to us, so I want to put that out there. One of the limitations, obviously, is the building.
Right.
And the building is old, and it needs a lot of work. And one of the things, there's a potential if we put – so whatever the value of the building is, and I just learned this, that if you put in over 50% of the value of the building, it triggers in new code as well. So mm-hmm. it would cost more money because you have to put sprinkler systems and you got to bring it up to today's code.
Right.
So at some point, you know, you have to look at it and say, is it worth the cost? Is it going to be, you know, and how much work really is done.
Right.
And we've had peripheral estimates, but once you dig deeper, it's going to be more.
Yeah.
And so.
And the school's over 100 years old.
It is.
Correct?
It
1914
is.
Or 17?
1914.
14. So, I mean, you're talking 109 years old now that the
listen, buildings have a lifespan.
Right, right.
And 100 years is probably about it, I think.
Right.
You know, and but both of the schools, the custodians do a nice job, mm-hmm. but you can only do it with what you have to work with. Right,
right. Right.
So I believe preschool for every student, whether they're going to the Boys and Girls Club, whether mm-hmm. they're going to the Y, whether it's our program. I don't look at it as a competition. It's a collaboration.
Right, right.
Because we know that every student that has a preschool experience is going to do better in life.
Right.
And we
right.
want, you know, they're less likely to get suspended. I mean, it's just there's so much research out there that supports that.
Right.
The other thing that we, Student Opportunity Act, that we wanted to do is expand our early college program, mm-hmm. which we've done.
Right.
With
right.
Westfield State. And we do have dual enrollment with HCC and mm-hmm. so on. In fact, we have a course coming up, and we're just in the planning stages of this with HCC, a manufacturing type program for high school kids after school hours,
right.
partnering with HCC if they're interested.
Right.
And of course, why is the manufacturing world doing this? Because they need employees.
Right. Right.
So, people are getting creative as mm-hmm. to how to have this happen. And our third one was to solidify and expand our alternative programming. And we've done that as well. And the reason being is, so you had talked about it a little bit before and alluded to the fact that, you know, not all of the kids were engaged during remote learning.
Mm-hmm.
And so they didn't get all the credits that they need. So
right.
we needed to build a credit recovery pathway for our students. So they get a mixture of in-person learning and virtual.
Sure.
Through a company we partner with called Edgenuity.
Mm-hmm.
So those are our three goals. And those, I think they're good goals.
Mm-hmm.
I think that
they're attainable.
They're attainable.
The big thing is that the goals are attainable.
Well, if you set a goal that's not attainable, what are you doing?
Well,
but I think, you know, those are things that we really want to see happen. So in terms of Fort Meadow, we're looking for another location,
mm-hmm.
potentially. There was talk about putting some of the programming into our elementary schools. I don't know if we have the room for all
right,
of this,
right.
but all I know is that we have to do, you know, if we expect better outcomes for our students, we need to implement pre-K
right.
for
right.
everybody.
Right. Agreed. And as we wind down here,
well,
I do.
That's the fastest hour
yeah,
I've had
yeah,
in a while.
Well,
I just want you to know
so
that.
So you're welcome.
Yeah, thank you.
So
that's
I
great.
Think what before we close out here, one of the things I do want to mention is our legislative luncheon that we're going to be holding that we
yes.
do in October every year. And it's typically jump around to the different country clubs in the area. I got an idea from a colleague of mine. Why don't you do it at the schools? So Stefan and I are working on putting the legislative luncheon here at the Tech Academy. And then how great is it that the school's going to see the local legislation walking around,
absolutely.
Our state senators, state reps walking around, seeing what's going on at the Tech Academy. I think it's going to be a home run. And lunch will be provided by the kids.
By the kids. And I'll tell you what, they do a bang-up job. I think Pete will agree on that.
Maybe we could broadcast the Q&A session.
Oh.
We could.
That'd be something.
We could.
Next drop over.
It yeah, really, yeah. Really,
that's why I point when you see me pointing over there, folks. Whether it's my show or Mark Auerbach's or Ken's, whatever show I'm on, I'm referring to culinary because
right.
it's right next door.
Right, right.
And sometimes when
I know
cooking,
the smell. Yes,
you can smell what they're cooking.
Right.
So
right.
I gain weight sitting here smelling.
I know it's amazing.
Brutal.
And I've been, you know, on my show we do like we celebrate days. So like, what was the last one we had? It was National Whipped Cream Day.
Wow.
So okay. we had a demonstration right there. Thank you, Pete, again. A student made fresh whipped cream for us
wow.
and then had made chocolate mousse to put the whipped cream on. Fresh whipped cream is so much better than the can or Cool Whip.
Of course it is.
It's just, and watching her make it, she explained it. So we brought them on in the pet. We've had Apple Fritter Day.
Mm-hmm.
We've done cupcakes, National Double Cheeseburger Day. So I like to obviously showcase their talent.
Right, right. And it's all very good.
It really is.
Had a bad meal over there.
No, they have a buffet this Friday, folks. So open from 10:45 to 12:15.
Yeah.
Stop on by. You won't regret it.
Right, right.
So. Are you going, Pete?
Possibly. I might have another engagement that day.
Okay. Well, they have.
I'll go for you, Pete. Don't
worry. Yeah, never have I had a bad meal.
Yeah.
Never.
It's unbelievable.
And then they do the bakery, too. It's
right,
like, oh.
Right. It's everything. So
it really is.
All right. Well, as we close out the show here, Stefan, thanks for a great conversation. You're right. It was a quick hour here, but a great update on what's going on with the schools and what the chamber is doing to support the school system and vice
and
versa.
We thank you. Yes.
And thank you for everything you do for us. And again, we'll see everybody next month. Again, my guest, Stefan Zaporowski, superintendent of Westfield Schools here on WCPC Channel 15, WSKB 89.5. Take it away, Peter.
Underwriting support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Greater Westfield Chamber of Commerce, the voice of business for the Greater Westfield.